present something.
Okay, everyone, welcome back to the Helsinki University startup stage here at Slush 2019. We're also streaming this to Think Corner, so welcome to everybody watching over there. I have here with me now two guests from the United States. I have Rebeca Hwang, welcome. You are a serial entrepreneur, an investor, and you are Senior Director of Center for Family Business and Entrepreneurship at Thunderbird School of Management. Welcome. And we have Patrick Ennis, who's a venture partner at Madrona Ventures, which is a big venture capital firm based in Seattle, right? And you also have a lot of other duties at different companies, and you're teaching at the Washington University as well.
Yes.
So Rebeca, if we start with you, I know that you have taught entrepreneurship, for example, at Stanford University. How do you think we should go about encouraging researchers to become entrepreneurs and students?
Yeah, so I think it starts with the performance evaluations that you give to researchers. If their entire evaluation system at universities is based on citations and publications and teaching, then they don't have a lot of incentives to go out and start other businesses or learn about entrepreneurship. So if as a university, you do want some of that innovation to go outside of the walls of the university, then you do have to have a system that creates bonus points for those researchers if they do, for example, patent, if they do and do internships in the summers with in industry, for example. And also, I think that there is a personal development aspect of it. So one goal is to get some of this innovation to spin out, but the other goal could be to train those individuals to be more resilient and to be more adaptable. And the entrepreneurial mindset and those tools can be applicable to anything, to the public sector, to nonprofits, even in research, you know, that mentality of experimenting and iterating frequently and failing small and fast. And so I think from the perspective of their personal growth, it could be a class that is encouraged for the entire university, an entrepreneurship class.
And can you teach entrepreneurship to academics and researchers?
Oh, absolutely. At Stanford, for example, there are different levels of technology entrepreneurship that is taught. So some of them is for people who want to start businesses that are undergrads, but there is one specific class that is geared towards PhDs and researchers with an innovation or a patent or an invention that is a lot more high tech, right? It's not just an idea, but they do have some core innovation that they want to apply in the market. And so there are definitely classes that can be geared towards researchers and academics.
I think the aspects that you bring up, like rewarding researchers, for example, for patents and so on, are something that we talk about here in Finland, but we haven't really implemented yet. So I think that's something for us to think about and learn also the how to teach entrepreneurship. So Patrick, you are also on the commercialization board of Helsinki University, so you know the startups coming from Helsinki University very well. How do you think they compare to what you see in Seattle and in North America, and what are perhaps the challenges and the strengths that a university like Helsinki University could have in competition with all the startups coming out of Stanford or American top universities?
Yeah, the great news is I think all the startups that are coming out of the University of Helsinki are truly world-class, and I don't say that lightly. I spent the last 25 years traveling the world working with startups all across America, all around the world, and I think what's fascinating about the startups here is it's similar to some of the startups you might see in Israel, which also has a relatively small population compared to the larger countries like China or the US. But because of that small population, they're forced to look outward and be aware of what's going on all around the world. And that really makes an entrepreneur very fleet of foot and very agile. So I've been very, very impressed by what we've seen coming out of here. In terms of improvements, well, no one's perfect, so it's not a criticism to talk about improvements. And this is a broad generalization, so please forgive me. But a lot of the entrepreneurs tend to be a little bit too modest and a little bit too shy. you really have to break through the noise, and not everyone needs to be a rude American like myself, but I think it would help a little bit if you are a little bit louder and have a little bit more of a sales focus, and don't be so shy when promoting the capabilities of your company.
That is an excellent point. I myself, I'm from Finland, but I lived in the US for 10 years, and the difference is so big. So you think it's really a big difference in terms of business as well and attracting investors if you know how to talk about your invention and sell it?
Yeah, it's true. That's a great point when you mention invention, because it's not just about the business. It's first about the technology and getting people excited about that. If you can't communicate your idea in simple language to non-experts, you're really going to have difficulty attracting not only investing, but also attracting customers. And even if you communicate clearly, if you don't communicate with passion to show that you're super excited about it, why should anyone else be excited about it?
That is so different. I think that comes to mentality of different countries also. And in Finland, we're not really used to thinking that we have to tell others about our work. The work stands for itself. Oh, that's what we think. But so, Rebeca, we also talk a lot about diversity in tech, and here at Slush too, it's an important part of Slush program. But it's also difficult. A lot of tech companies, startups, are often still very white and male. At the same time, universities are increasingly, the students are female, a lot of the researchers, academic staff are female. How do you see we could, how could we encourage more diversity in the startups that come out of universities here in Finland than anywhere in the world?
Yes, and this is the problem, by the way, that we have in Silicon Valley as well. We do have a heavy bias towards men starting and getting more funding businesses in Silicon Valley. And I think it starts with education and spreading information about the value of diversity. When you have a team with founding team members that have diversity, not just in terms of gender, but age, religion, ethnicity, backgrounds, and experiences, those companies do perform better. And that has been proven over and over and over. And so I think it's very important to be able to communicate that to all founders, founder wannabes, so that they know that they have to get a very diverse and complete team. On the other hand, the reason why a lot of people don't engage with people who are different from one is that there are difficulties and challenges in trying to work with people who are not just like you and don't share a lot of experiences with you. And there are tools to deal with that. So I do believe that most entrepreneurship classes should include some knowledge in terms of how to deal with those diversity issues and overcome those so that you can be effective as a team. But specifically, if there's an issue in Finland or in the Nordic countries around, let's say, for example, women who are not participating, it's important to understand why. Sometimes it's because there are societal expectations. Sometimes the system establishes incentives towards women to prioritize certain things, like maybe motherhood or, you know, staying home with the kids for a whole year. And how do those systems influence your ability to break through and really target specific issues so that you can get rid of those barriers for women?
And so, Patrick, as an investor, what is your take on that, especially in terms of talking about science-related startups and companies? How do you see we could encourage diversity, and what could investors do in this regard? Should they somehow do more?
Oh, yeah, of course. We should all do more. I think sometimes what's frustrating for people is they want quick results, but really it's about pipeline and role models. So you should certainly try to fund more diverse teams today, but we should also spend a lot of our time with kids and telling them that they can be an entrepreneur, they can be a scientist. So we do a lot of that in Seattle. We devote a lot of time and energy to meeting with school kids and telling them that there's lots of career opportunities open for them, because I do think it's all about role models and being patient. And then hopefully one day you'll see the pipeline be much bigger at the top in terms of the supply of entrepreneurs and scientists from all shapes and sizes, from all walks of life.
And so to go back to the challenges and opportunities that a university like Helsinki University in Finland could have in terms of startups, What do you think, what would you say to investors, and what are the things that investors are looking for and they could find at the University of Helsinki? And is there something that Helsinki University could do better to attract international investors? We already talked about communication skills, but apart from that.
Yeah, well, let's first talk about the strengths. Because of the size of University of Helsinki, there's so many different departments and expertise across a wide variety of technologies. The future is all about interdisciplinary technologies and the convergence of different technologies as markets become more integrated. So that's a great strength. Because if you look at a lot of the startups, let's say in healthcare, they're no longer healthcare only. They're often healthcare with a large amount of IT. You know, AI as applied to medical diagnosis. And small universities have trouble competing because they don't necessarily have expertise in all those departments. In terms of competing, I think emphasizing technology transfer at all levels, not just with professors and graduate students, but also undergrads, to let them know that entrepreneurship is an option, to be flexible. If a student wants to take a few months or even a year or two off, they should be able to do that easily without filing a lot of paperwork, and they should be welcome back to the university if they want to come. Those types of flexible policies really help when you're recruiting entrepreneurial folks from around the world.
And what do you think of, Rebeca, in terms of investor and investing in science startups that come, if you look at it from American perspective, and you would consider, for example, investing in something that is from University of Helsinki or some similar European university, what do you think might be things going through your head?
Well, I have to say, as a group, investors are kind of lazy. So when you're in the US, you know, we joke in Silicon Valley that our investors, as they get comfortable in their positions, they don't want to travel more than an hour by car to see their deals. So if you really want them to come to Europe, if you want them to be serious about investing their time and capital in getting to know the Finnish ecosystem, there is a job of branding that you have to do as a university to very clearly articulate this is the place you come to find companies that have X, Y, and Z. And then make it super easy for them to invest in those companies by creating standards. So for example, most investors from the US will want to invest in companies that are incorporated in Delaware. And so the European system, the European documents, we don't really understand them, and that involves the risk. So lowering some of those risks by standardizing the whole process is going to make it easier for those investors. But then I think the most important first step is for you guys to get a few friendly partners at firms in the US to get to know you very well, and for them to become the amplifiers of the potential that you guys have. Because especially in Silicon Valley, it's really a matter of social validation. People will come and co-invest with you if there is one person that they believe in from there who knows you and says, these guys are legit. That will be one of the most important elements that we'll want to see in the deal.
And luckily we have Patrick in our corner. So I think, do you agree with that? Is that the way?
Yeah, it's great advice. I almost always agree with Rebeca. So we've known each other and worked together now for about 11 years. I've been coming to Helsinki since 2008, and I do think the ecosystem has just developed so much, and it continues to develop further. Just Slush is a great example. There's 20,000 plus people from all around the world here, from US, from Asia, from South America, and that's a cumulative type of advantage. Even if there's a particular startup that may not be ready to rise up from this conference, maybe someone got inspired from a meeting that they had today, and that will result in the founding of a startup later this year. So I think something like Slush is actually invaluable for the startup ecosystem here in Finland.
Well, thank you very much, Rebeca and Patrick, for your thoughts, and thanks for coming all the way from Silicon Valley to Helsinki. Looking forward to continuing discussions. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.